concern, our purpose, our sense of mission, our challenge to go forth as disciples into every town, village, and crossroad, proclaiming the love of Christ.
Thank you. is you not wretch? It is not clay nor feeder. It is not none nor foul. There are sin either in Christ Jesus Son.
The love of God and sin to everyone. We are all God's people.
Armenia. Aspatrin, Serbucha, Churi.
Join hands with brothers of this faith, whatever our race may be, to serve the Father, the Son, to serve the King to be.
We are the children.
message that was shared with all of us. I'd like to call on Pam Tudor to please come and give you a welcome.
Good morning and welcome. What a beautiful, beautiful beginning. My God, just a very, very special moment. I'm glad I'm here and I know who you are. So we have a tradition here at the First Congregational Church of Naples. We welcome any first-time visitor. So for any visitor that has never been here, could you please stand? We have a few, I think. No? Well, anyhow, welcome to all of you. We're so glad that you have joined us here on Motley this morning, and we hope to see you all next time. So thank you.
Thank you, Pam, for that wonderful welcome. I know everyone is enjoying the service and the procession of the flags because we are indeed one people. We are all God's people from around the world, and we are joined together, indeed, at the table of the Lord. Now I'd like to call on Barbara Pierce to come and share a word with you.
I'm really excited about the women's retreat, and I know you will be too when you see the flyer, which you can pick up in Zelenskis Hall. We have a great program planned, so please pick up your flyer. If you can take a couple extras and put them up where you live or work or shop, that would be great, because we'd love to see all of you and all your friends. So see you then.
What a nice announcement. Thank you so much, Barbara, for sharing with us the women's retreat is coming just around the corner. I want to remind the men of the church that in the morning, it's Monday morning men, our first men's gathering for breakfast for the new fall season. We'll have a great breakfast, I promise you, and we invite you to come and be a part of that. I remind you that next Saturday, this coming Saturday, is the Frank Rothman Invitational Golf Tournament. We're excited about that. It will be held at Bonita Bay East in the golf tournament at the dinner at Bonita Bay Club. We have a number of people who've signed up. There might be a few more volunteers if you'd like to watch and hold part three during the course of the day. If you would send me or Frank following the service, we can certainly do sure help. Or if you haven't signed up for play, we invite you to do so as well. Remind you that next Sunday is a special day in the life of our church, Disabilities Awareness Sunday. We have a wonderful person who is going to speak, one who is visually impaired, Nikki Urey, who is with us this morning. I know you will be inspired by our words from Nikki's presentation and presence in the service. I call your attention to the other opportunities as they are listed in the bulletin. Also, I want to remind you or inform you that we have some folks who stand in need of your prayers. If you would remember them, a prayer, a card. Just learned yesterday that Jacqueline is going to have more radiation for the cancer that has apparently reappeared, so please keep Jack in your thoughts and prayers. And also, his wife Don is having some health issues as well. Flo and Walter Schaefer are in New York, but Flo is, or Walter, is being diagnosed with some issues in his life, and also Flo, unfortunately, just before they were to leave for this trip to New York, hurt her ankle and her leg, so she's had a cast as well. So keep Flo and Walter in your prayers, along with the other people who are listed in our bulletin. Now, please continue our service with an international song. It's sung in
Thank you.
Portuguese. Would you like your translation? We'll just leave that on the table. We'll leave it on the table, okay. Preparation for the message today, let us hear the word of God read from the book of Acts, chapter 20. Hear these words. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered to break bread, Paul talked with them, intending to depart on the morrow, and he prolonged his speech until midnight. There were many lights in the upper chamber where they were gathered, and a young man named Eutychus was sitting in the window. He sank into a deep sleep as Paul talked still longer. Being overcome by sleep, he fell down to the third story and was taken up dead. Paul went down and bent over him and embraced him and said, "Do not be alarmed, for his life is in him." And when Paul had gone up and broken bread and eaten, he conversed with them a long while until daybreak, and so departed. And they took the lad away alive and were not a little comforted. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his word. Now, of course, the Apostle Paul was a little more wordy than I am. If you get a little tired in a 20-minute message, just remember that Paul preached all night, the breaking of the day. Well, you know, there's an old saying, an army marches on its stomach. Well, what does that mean? It means men and women are hungry. They cannot fight a battle. They get discouraged, disheartened, and lose the will to fight. Without food, the army just cannot fight. Giving food to soldiers has always been a logistics problem. When you have an army of 10,000 or 50,000 or 100,000 soldiers, how do you feed that entire army? How do you get the food from one place to another? Can you imagine the logistics of Napoleon or Genghis Khan that had hundreds of thousands of soldiers who went across Europe and Asia? But what about the war between the states, that unfortunate war, how tens of thousands of men had to be fed wherever they were in this country? The logistics of getting food to the soldiers is of utmost importance. Back in World War II, the Allied forces tried to solve this problem with what they call a package of K-rations. Now, some of our men who were in World War II might remember the K-rations. There were rations for a day's supply of food, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. But in total, there were only 900 calories in all of those three boxes of K rations. And a soldier could not go very long on 900 calories. So we make this application to that the army does indeed march on its stomach, but so do the people of God. Your God march on their stomach. How they are fed. The imagery of Christians marching on their stomach, and in fact being soldiers, is an imagery in the Bible that you cannot overlook. In fact, one of the great gospel hymns of the church, "Onward, Christian soldiers, march we as to war, the cross of Jesus going on before." You could probably sing that hymn from memory. The book of Philemon, that short little book of Paul's, to Philemon, chapter 1, verse 2, Paul refers to Archippus as this fellow soldier. Soldier. In the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verse 25, Paul refers to Epaphroditus as my brother, fellow worker, and listen to this, my fellow soldier. Look at Timothy, chapter 2, verse 3, 2 Timothy. Endure hardships, Paul says, with us like a good plateau. The fact in Ephesians we read that we are, in chapter 6, Paul says, put on the whole armor of God, full armor, that you might take a stand against the evil one, the evil that is in the world. And he goes on to say, we as God's people fight against principalities and against darkness. So we are soldiers, we are at war, and indeed, we need to be. There must be food for the army of God. What are we going to eat? Where is the food for the army? Jesus has supplied us with a very, very special meal, the most special meal in all the world. We call it Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist. The early church took this most seriously. In chapter 2 of Acts, we read, when the church first met, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, and listen to the breaking of bread, sharing the body of Christ. The 20th chapter of Acts, we read that on the first day of the week, we came together to do what? Break bread. To remember the broken body of the Lord. And in fact, in 150 A.D., a Christian leader by the name of Justin Martyr wrote, on Sunday, the meeting was held of all who believe in the city, the cities and in the villages, sharing of bread and the wine. Every single Sunday, the church took communion. Right? In the 20th chapter of the book of Acts, we're told the reason they were at church was one reason. Came together to break the bread and to share. By the time of the 20th chapter of Acts, Paul was quite a famous evangelist, going to all the churches of Asia Minor, spreading the gospel. And who wouldn't want to come and hear Paul, the great apostle, the man who's spreading the gospel around the known world? Who wouldn't want to hear him and meet him? But I tell you, they chose to meet Paul. They came to the service, breaking the bread and sharing of the covenant. Why was the meal so important? What was it about bread and wine that was so important to the early Christians? First of all, when they took communion, they were sitting down at the table with Jesus. It's his meal, his food, his table. Secondly, the communion table is where you and I are reminded of our mission. As often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you show forth the Lord's death until he comes. So, really take the bread and wine. It's a testimony of faith, showing forth his love, remembering him until he comes. Thirdly, when we take the Lord's supper, we remember why we're here. Whatever happens in the service, and wonderful things always happen in services of worship, music, singing hymns, prayers, the message, fellowship. But it is the bread and the wine that remind you and me that Christ died for our sins. In the first letter of Timothy in chapter 1, we read these words, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Communion reminds us that we are all sinners. No one of us has measured up to the mark that was set by Christ Jesus. We're not here to be entertained. We're not here to be catered to. We're here as a testimony of fact, do you know why the early Christians met on Sunday rather than Saturday, the Sabbath day? There was a transition of the days that were thought of as holy days. The Jewish faith set aside the Sabbath day, Saturday, as a time of reverence. Nothing happened on that day. It was a day totally committed to all reverence to God. As a reminder of God's creation, the Sabbath day, creation was complete. Christians celebrate Sunday, the first day of the week, as the holy day, because it is a reminder to the body of Christ that on the third day, Christ rose from the dead. It's a celebration. And Sunday is the first day. Communion reminds believers of the power of Christ over death and his glorious resurrection. So why did the early Christians take communion every week? Why couldn't they just take it occasionally, once a month, every quarter, or less often? They had in mind the sacrament. They wanted was the central part of the service. They would have starved spiritually if they had not come together for the spiritual food. One more thing that catches our attention in this lesson this morning. In Acts 20, 7th verse, hear these words. They came together for the breaking of bread. There's a common misconception. People don't need to be in church to worship God. We hear this many times in recent days. They say, well, you know, I can find God down on the beach, on the seashore, or out someplace else. Kind of long range of Christians. That's the long range of approach to faith. Communion exposes the thoughts that they have. Communion actually comes from Greek word koinonia, meaning having a common partnership, a common fellowship in the Lord. It's meant to be a shared experience with one another, with people of faith, the family of God. It is a time when God's army comes to base of strength. We gain strength. The army is to have a motto, an army of one. You have to have an army of one. Frankly, I doubt any soldier wants to be in a battle, especially on the front lines of an army of one. You know what soldiers say? We hear every soldier that comes back from wherever they're serving, we are a family. The spirit of family of us. Arms, protection of our country. Most everyone here is familiar with Chris Kyle, famous American sniper for whom the movie was made. While in Iraq, he returned not once, not twice, not three times, but four times. Who is going back? Now, his wife, Taya, I never understand. She would beg me, plead with me, take him by the back of the shirt and say, Chris, stay here. I love you. We need you here. He and Taya had a little boy. The little boy was a toddler. Chris was at home when the little guy was born. He was in Iraq. A little boy grew and became a toddler and such a precious little fellow. Ty couldn't understand. Why are you going back? You belong here. I want you to hear Chris's words. We are a family. I've got to be there. My family. How would you see? That's the spirit core
soldiers. We are a family. Like this did come home. And unfortunately, it also left after such experiences as four tours of duty. Communion table declares, this table right here declares, we need one another. We are. And today, the special Sunday, you understand that the whole world, all the leaders, all around the world, we are all one family. It doesn't matter whether we are Protestants, Catholics, Orthodox, Armenian Christians, whatever our affirmation of faith, we are. And the table reminds us as such. So I remind you this morning as we gather around this table, the words of our opening hymn. Remember those words, one table spread throughout the whole wide earth. Did you know that one third of the world's population is of the Christian faith? Imagine that. So many doomsayers say faith is becoming passé, thing of the past. Well, when the Pope came to America, we saw hundreds of thousands of people gather just to sit over and receive a blessing. Our faith is not dead, but we ask. We are one family, and on occasions like that, we still spread. God. A third of the world is of the Christian faith. What a great army! Can you imagine an army that consists of 33% of the entire population of the world? Now, during World War II, some parts of the K rations were so valuable. I mean, you know, these men out on the battlefield were hungry. 900 calories just wouldn't cut it. Go on the calories and take up an arm and fight a battle, you just couldn't do it. So the soldiers sometimes used the K rations as currency, bartering, precious commodity. That little box of K rations, how important for strength and power of the body. But we need to remember, especially on this particular day, the long days. These sacred symbols are precious, precious commodities. It's broken blood. It's shed blood. Common word in communion is unity. Common unity. Common unity with one another. Common unity with God's people all around the world. Take it in. God's own sacrifice. Amen. Let us respond to the word of God. Thank you.
is always the practice of our church to invite all to the Lord's table. If you're here as a visitor, we invite you to partake of these sacred substances of bread and wine, because we believe the Lord indeed is the host of the table. And remember today, as we celebrate the sacrament, that we're not doing it alone, not just with those of us who are gathered here this morning, but we're celebrating the sacrament with God's people around the world. When you eat the bread, think about the love that is shared. All God's children. When you partake of the cup, think about that you're not partaking of the cup within yourself. You're partaking of the cup, the shed blood of Christ. God's people, wherever they're found on the earth. Even if they truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, walking from henceforth in God's holy ways, draw near by faith to take this holy sacrament to your comfort, as you make your humble confession to Almighty God. Let us hear the words of institution given by the Apostle Paul in the Corinthians when he said these words. For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, This is my body which is broken for you. In the same manner, after they had supped, he took the cup and he said, This is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you. Drink ye all of it. And in that same section of admonition, Paul said to the Corinthian Christians, as the Lord says to us, that a person should examine himself or herself in coming to the Lord's table. Responding to that admonition, let us confess our sins to Almighty God in preparation to receive the sacrament. Mighty God, we do not presume to come to this your table, trusting in our own goodness or righteousness, but that of your Son, who was and is the Lamb of God that was slain for the sins of the world. He indeed is the expiation of our sins. We confess before you, we're not all that we could be or should be. Not said or done the things that we should or could have done. Have mercy upon us as we receive this holy bread and wine. Restore us into that right and whole relationship with you through Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, hear the words of the Lord. He who comes unto me, I will in no wise cast out. Queens of God, for the people of God, come, for all things are ready.
Paul said the cup of blessing which we bless is it not participation in the blood of Christ. Drink ye all of it. The Gospels remind us that after they met in the upper room, they offered a prayer of thanksgiving. The meal received. You join me in our prayer. Thanks to God. My God, we thank you that you have blessed us and this whole world. As we have all gathered around your table as guests, your Son, Christ, is indeed the host. May these sacred substances of bread and wine nourish our bodies and our souls to bear the good news. You are alive. Amen.
Thank you.
throughout the world and one Lord. Thank you for being here this day and sharing in the worship of the Lord. Your presence makes the service so very special. Everyone is invited to commence this hall for a time of fellowship following the service. Go forth in the love of God, go forth in hope and in joy. Know that God is with you, peace of God, which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of Christ Jesus. The blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you.